Hello students, I welcome you all. I am Manoj Jain, your English teacher. Today we are going to study literature part from the syllabus of class 10 English language and literature. But before that, let me inform you, we have three books in class 10th and our first topic is the first poem from the book First Flight. As you can see, the name Dust of Snow. Dust of Snow is a small poem written by Robert Frost in the year 1923. Students, do you know about this great American poet? Let me tell you something about this poet. Robert Frost is regarded as one of the most celebrated and critically respected poet of America in the 20th century. Born in San Francisco to a journalist father, Frost attempted writing poetry while working in a farm and teaching in a school. After writing many poems, he decided to get them published in the form of a book, but American editors rejected his submitted poems. It was the worst phase of his life. He had two options left now, either to stay back in America as a failure or try his luck in some other country. Finally, a momentous decision came in his life. He decided to move to England in the year 1912. And then, following year, his poems were published by London publisher. His second book was also published the very next year. Frost became very famous there, and then he decided to return to his own country, that is America. He was determined to win a reputation in his own country, which he gradually achieved. He became one of the country's best loved poets. Frost did not experiment with new words, but tried traditional patterns. His poems depict realistic life through language and situation familiar to common man. Students, as you can see, I have specifically mentioned about a poem that is The Road Not Taken. Though this poem is not in your syllabus, but I suggest you to read this poem. This poem is going to inspire you in true sense. Now let us read the poem The Dust of Snow. The way a crow swooped down on me, the dust of snow from a hemlock tree has given my heart change of mood and saved some part of a day I had rued. Now, let us first discuss the theme of the poem. Students, we are always surrounded by negativities, but if we are persistent and stay calm, something small but wonderful things can happen in our lives. These small things can transform our sorrow or pensive mood into joyful mood. Now let us learn the poem Dust of Snow. As you can see, this poem has two stanzas. Each stanza has four lines. Students, you may have noted down that there are some important words which I have underlined. First, I will explain them so that it becomes easier for you to understand this poem. The first word is crow. Crow is a symbol of inauspicious thing. In the second line, first word shook, and shook means mood. In the third line, we have two important words. First is dust, the second one is snow. Dust is commonly associated with soil, but here it is associated with snow. Snow, as you all know, is a symbol of peace and joy. In the last line of first stanza, we have hemlock. Now, hemlock is a tree which is very poisonous with white flowers. This hemlock tree is often associated with death or sorrow. Now, in the next stanza, you will find the last word to be a little bit difficult. This word is rude. And root means held in regret.
Students, let me explain the poem in detail. The way a crow swooped down on me, the dust of snow from a hemlock tree. Who is me over here? It is the poet. Where was the poet? The poet was standing under a hemlock tree. Students, it was a winter time. The hemlock tree was covered with snow. A crow was sitting on the top of this tree. When this crow moved, dust of snow, means particles of snow, fell on the poet. Has given my heart a change of mood and saved some part of a day I had ruined. Now, what happened? Particles of snow fell on the poet. As a result of that, the mood of the poet was changed completely. He was in pensive mode and now he was delighted. See here, has given my heart a change of mood. The last two lines, and saved some part of a day I had ruined. The poet was regretting about the day being wasted. But now he was feeling very delighted as he was able to save the remaining part of the day. I hope you have understood the poem. Now let us revise the main points quickly. There was a hemlock tree. The poet was standing under the tree. This tree was covered with snow. And a crow was sitting. Due to the movement of the crow, pieces of snow fell on the poet. As a result of this, the mood of the poet changed completely. His pensive mood was converted into a happy mood. Now students, we need to discuss few more things. As you can see, the poet could have easily used some other birds or trees in place of this crow or hemlock tree, but he didn't. He wanted to present the nature in a different way. Students, his aim was to convey a strong message to the people of this world. No creature is insignificant. They play important role directly or indirectly. Let me explain this. Where was the crow? The crow was on the tree. Why it was there? It was there naturally. The poet was standing under the tree. What happened? Due to movement of the crow, pieces of snow fell on the poet, which changed the mood. Now see, crow, inauspicious bird, hemlock tree, a poisonous tree, they both have helped directly or indirectly to change the mood of the poet, which is very important. So students, we must respect and appreciate nature. If we are appreciating nature, if we are respecting nature, nature will play its part to get rid of all the miseries, troubles that we face in our day-to-day life. This is all about this point. Now we are going to critically analyze this point. You may remember this term, that is literary devices. It is also called figures of speech. Literary devices or figures of speech are very important. They make the poem effective, or rather I would say they add something new to the meaning of any piece of writing. Now let us first discuss literary devices used in this poem. As you can see, the last word of every line. rhyming words, but they are not in a successive manner. Just see. The last word of first line is grow. The second word is me. The pronunciation of grow does not match with the pronunciation of me. Hence, these two words are not rhyming words. Now let us see third and fourth word. Third one is snow, and it is exactly similar to the pronunciation of crow. The last word, that is tree, matches with the pronunciation of me. So we can mark them as crow, small a, me, small b, again snow, small a, and tree, small b. Now let us do the same thing in the second stanza. Heart has similar sound to that of part. Let us mark it as A. So this will be also treated as A. The second word, mood, it matches with the pronunciation of root. This is B. Then this is also B. Now see the rhyme scheme of both the stanza. It is A, B, A, B. I hope it is clear. Now I will discuss with you another figure of speech, that is symbolism. While reading the poem, you may have noted down three important words. First one, crow. Second one, hemlock tree. The third one, snow. This is also B. Now see the rhyme scheme of both the stanza. It is A, B, A, B. I hope it is clear. Now I will discuss with you another figure of speech, that is symbolism. While reading the poem, you may have noted down three important words. First one, crow. Second one, hemlock tree. The third one, snow. Crow is a symbol of inauspicious thing. Hemlock tree is a symbol of something dangerous or connected with death. And snow is a symbol of peace and joy. So these are actually the example of symbolism. Now we will move on to the last part of this poem, or rather I would say literary device in this poem. If you have noted down closely, just see here, has heart. Has is the alphabet repeated in the last word. It is a consonant. When consonant sounds are repeated, they are called alliteration. I hope you are aware about this. It is called alliteration because they are sound producing words starting with consonant. The same thing we can find in third line also. S, S. Consonant repeated producing similar sound. Hence, they are also example of alliteration. So in this way, we can find that there are three important literary devices used in this poem. The first one, rhyme scheme, ABAB. Second one, symbolism. And third one is alliteration. There are many other literary devices. Those devices are not used in this poem, but they are used in different poems. In my coming classes, I am going to discuss in detail about all these figures of speech along with other important literary devices. That's all in today's class. I hope you have understood. See you next time with another important topic.